Share my screen. So, chapter 6. The book has two chapters dealing with networks, chapter 6 and chapter 7. And chapter 7 is dedicated to wide area networks. This means that you go out of a parcel. This means that you go out into public available networks, typically owned by the telephone companies or the internet providers. In old days, the telephone company were your internet provider, but now this is a very different market. So your television provider could also be your internet provider, and they can also provide you with your internet. So we have a lot of different. Yeah. So, what did you say, Victor?
Just like you see this.
Yes, you see who does that, this company. So what we was teaching in the data communication courses 10 to 15 years back were that we are taught these fast switches that you are going to use the telephone company standards for this fast switching, where you took in, split all the traffic up in mini packages, and these were fit into some big switches, and they had a big standard for that, the telephone companies, and we were teaching that at the universities. And then I found out after 4 or 5 years that what they did inside the telephone companies' networks were not using these gigantic switches that we were teaching at the university. They used the internet for transferring all the telephone calls and all the data packets. So then I gave up teaching that. So what happens inside the wide area networks is just a mystery. You know, they do what they normally do with the telephone companies. And they are now dominated by light fibers in the switches in the internet. So switching data traffic from light fibers onto other light fibers, this is just some magic that we don't know about. So chapter 7 is now obsolete, but chapter 6 still holds a lot of good points, and this is why we talk about it today also. So we look at joint scheduling of tasks and messages in distributed systems, and joint scheduling, the reason why we use the joint is that we have a lot of techniques for scheduling inside a CPU or a group of CPUs sharing the same memory. And we have a lot of ways to deal with real-time messages in distributed systems. We have a handful to a dozen communication protocols, which can take real-time into account also. And we'll look into these in this chapter. So let's have a look. What are we doing in distributed real-time systems? And what we are actually distributing is, of course, hardware. We have the computation nodes and their interaction. I have to spell interaction. It's a non-existing word. So it should be interaction. Yeah. We are doing online teaching, so. Voila, magic, we've changed zero. So, of course, we have these computation nodes and their interactions. Sometimes we are forced into a distribution, and sometimes we use it as a feature. We use it as a way to build our system. So, for instance, some distributed systems are there because of their nature. For instance, if you look at a room control system, then we will have sensors. We have humidity sensors. We also have temperature sensors at different places in the room. And we also have some actuators. We have a ventilator channel into the room and so on. And we need to control the ventilation and on the basis of the temperature measurement and also light measurements. And also we have a measurement of how many people we have in the room and so on. And these are naturally distributed out in space. So this is an example of where the real-time system becomes distributed because of the nature of the system. But sometimes we're also forced to do it because the information are at different places that we need to have. And also the computation nodes could be at certain points in space. So we are forced to do distribution. So hardware is something that we need to think of in distributed system, that how we distribute the computation nodes and the interaction. And this is because the actuators and the sensors could be distributed. Okay. And then we also have to follow that distribution. And then we could also look at from the software point of view, where do we put our data? On which node is the data stored? For instance, a temperature sensor node is typically a very, very small node and it cannot hold all the data that it measures. So it needs to be sent to another node for storage. And also the processing allocation. If we look at in IoT systems, Internet of Things systems, the small sensors that we use in IoT, they can't do much. So the processing of the sensor data can often be forced to be done elsewhere in a more powerful node in the network. And then also the control allocation. So if you have a control loop, you have sensor and actuators, and then where do you control all this? Typically you will have a node doing that. So you have a control node for doing so. And then you have some nodes in your network where you have the actuators and you have the sensors. The room control example that I talked about before, this is a perfect example of this because the ventilator you are controlling is far away from the sensors that you have in play. So typically for a room, you will have a room controller taking care of the sensors, the temperature and humidity sensors and movement sensors and so on, and also controlling the valves for the heating and the valves for the inblowing of fresh air and so on. So for the software, we talk about data allocation, we talk about processing allocation and this control. And data allocation, if you look at big systems, you talk about data replication of safety. So you would prefer to have, for instance, two or three allocations where they have all the data stored. So if you lose one of the locations, then you still have all your data saved in two other locations. For instance, if you look in very big systems, for instance, banks, they will have all their data at different locations in case of fire. Then you shouldn't lose the whole history of the bank. So for instance, the Danske Bank, they have in Aarhus a lot of data, and they also have data in Copenhagen. And if you look at our own world, SDU, some years back, they had two separate server rooms in Odense, in two separate buildings. So if you had fire in one building and you lost your server room, then you had a full copy in another room and in another building of the data. Now all the data has moved into the cloud and they are somewhere. And two guys from university, IT, they went down to Belgium. And then they visit our data. And there was a guy down in Belgium pointing in the server room to a box and said, "This is where SDU data is stored." And they laughed a bit because who can control that? But because of EU rules, then EU data should be stored in Europe and not in America. Because in America, if you store your data in America, then NSA has the right, if they feel for it, then they have access to it. They can just tell the judge over there in America that, we want to look at these data. And they are in America. And then the judge will not. And they will go and just spy on all the data if they feel for it. So that's why we should store European data in Europe. And then we hope that no one will spy on it. Yeah, so it's a joke. So once your data has gone to the cloud, you don't know where it is anymore. So processing allocation, we have more control of that because this is where our program runs. But still, if you go to the cloud and ask Amazon to get a server for your data, for your processor, they will give you one. And you cannot really be sure where the server is placed in the universe. So if you go on big scale, data and processing allocations is just put into the cloud nowadays, and you have lost control of it. But typically, this is something you consider when you make a distributed system, especially data allocation. You should make sure that you don't lose your data. Processing allocation, this could also be duplicated. So if one node goes down, then your application does not go down because you can migrate your processing to another node, or you could have it duplicated in full. But as a software engineer doing real-time applications, we are considering very small networks in the order of a BeagleBone or so. So you could have some BeagleBones connected, or you could have some cores in a Raspberry Pi-like controller that you are controlling. So I like to think of it that we are controlling in the neighborhood of one room or so, or even in one table or so. Sometimes we can have remote nodes with some data links to them, but this is the area that we are going to cover. Yeah, so when we have distributed real-time system, we also get new problems. So the first problem we meet is that of clock. Typically, you only have one clock. When you are looking at BeagleBone, a BeagleBone has a clock, and you see PC also has one clock. But if you have several BeagleBones or several Raspberry Pis, then we have clocks which are drifting. And typically when you have a microcontroller, it has a clock inside, but the clock is typically of very low quality. It follows the pace of your microcontroller. So if you have a 16 megahertz microcontroller, then your clock will typically also be in the neighborhood of 16 megahertz. Most clocks are physically 30 megahertz clocks or so. And we have, for a BeagleBone, we had a project in Sunrise where we should timestamp the measurements from a solar panel, the solar panels, the measurements of energy and what the inverter was doing. And we wanted timestamps to be accurate in the neighborhood of 1 second. But the first shot at it, we had a BeagleBone working with it, and then a BeagleBone. And we discovered that the clocks, they were drifted for a whole day. The clock could drift up to 20 seconds. So when you wanted a 1 second time step on the measurements, this was pretty bad. So our programmer had to synchronize the clock of the BeagleBone and the BeagleBoard several times an hour. And we have, luckily on the internet, a lot of good clocks that you can use for synchronization, and then we solve the problem. But clock drifts is a real problem in distributed system. So if you can't rely on a common time, then you have a problem. This is also why this TSN networks in the future, the time-sensitive Ethernet, will come to our rescue, because one of the protocols in that protocol suite is dealing with a common clock in an Ethernet. And then the next thing here is, just like Einstein said, that we have the relativity, that time and delay of time is dependent on the system that you observe from. So it's a pure Einstein thing, the next one. So if you watch events from a distance, then you have communication delays, which delays these events. So if you want to know, react until to a flooding event with opening a valve, then it will, the valve will be opened immediately if you are very close. But if you sit in a town very far away, for instance, if you sit in Aarhus controlling the valves in Sønderborg, then the communication delay to Aarhus will actually delay the opening of the valve and the disaster can become bigger. So people, as a units in different places, they experience different delays of communication. So we have to cope with clock drifts and communication delays when you do our real-time scheduling. And furthermore, fault tolerance is also more complex, because when you have the problem of tolerating faults, you have to respect time constraints as well also. But fault tolerance is becoming more complex, this is true. But one of the big reasons for building distributed system is actually that we can get fault tolerance. So this is one of the drivers behind creating distributed real-time systems. So we shouldn't not be grumpy old men complaining about all the problems we get, because we get distributed systems. Distributed system is a feature to survive also. So if one node goes down in a distributed system, then we can still survive by moving a functionality to another node. So fault tolerance and is also one of the main drivers for building distributed real-time systems. And this is especially true in the military systems. Consider a big group of tanks approaching the enemy. Then when you attack the enemy with a group of tanks, then you must be prepared that some of your tanks will be blown up. And of course, the network should not depend on a master tank having control of the whole group of tanks. So they have this the famous flooding protocol, where you just flood all the messages to all who is around, and your control should be able to, so your control of your tank should be able to survive that you lose some of your tanks. So it's also a feature that fault tolerance becomes more adequate and more accessible in distributed systems. So in this book, we'll only consider the scheduling problem and not all the fault tolerance problems. So let's have a look at how we allocate tasks in real-time distributed systems. So we are dealing with this at two levels. We have local scheduling on one node. So inside one BeagleBone or one Raspberry Pi or one microcontroller, then we look, we schedule what the task which have been put on this node. And we have done so dealing with urgency, that is the deadlines, and also we can assign importance to our tasks, which are dealt with in overload situations. So this is local scheduling, and this is what we have been done in the book so far. But the global scheduling, then we allocate tasks to nodes. Which node is optimal for meeting the time constraints of a task? Of course, if we have in a control system, you have a lot of hard control applications. You have a very advanced control algorithm that you want to perform. And the node that you choose should have the power for dealing with this. And if you have a temperature measurement task, this is not heavy work, so you could choose a very weak node for that. It could be a little IoT circuit, which is don't have much energy, so it sleeps much of the time. So it wakes up and performs its temperature measures and goes to sleep again for 90% of the time. So it's a very weak node, and of course you shouldn't do much processing of the temperature that you're measuring with such a small IoT node. You should send it to a bigger node where you can do the storing and computation based on these temperatures. So you should consider which node is optimal for meeting the time constraints of a task, and then put the task on there. And back from the German car industry, in old days in the Volkswagen, they had about these 120 microcontrollers or routers in their car. And now you get more bang for the buck nowadays in the microcontrollers, they become cheaper. So they put the number of nodes down to, they're closer to 20 or 30 nodes in a car now, because microcontrollers are more powerful nowadays. So which of these nodes should take care of a task? This is what you do in global scheduling. You spread out tasks to nodes. And these two processes are very closely connected. Typically, it's a two-step approach. First, you do the global scheduling, spread out the tasks to the different nodes, and then you perform local scheduling on the nodes. And if it fails on some of the nodes, typically you put too many tasks on a node and you see that you can't produce a local schedule. Then of course you go back to step one, global scheduling. And then you try to put these tasks on other nodes to see if these other nodes can do it. So you loop around in these two processes, global scheduling, and then you try a local scheduling. If it fails on some nodes, then you go back again, spread the nodes out to other nodes and so on. And then you continue until you are satisfied with your system. Global scheduling, it can be static. This means that once you start your system, the tasks, they will stay where they are. But this is a very rigid system. And typically, you will actually prefer to do a dynamic scheduling. So some, as I said before, some nodes, they can be overloaded during runtime. And then it could be nice that you could move the functionality to other nodes. Or a node might fail. So in real life, nodes, they break down from time to time. They could lose their power, for instance. They could be damaged by an accident or so, because remember, we are doing embedded control, and they could be in harsh environments where they could be subject to a lot of heat, they also moisture and water and so on. There's a lot of damage could happen to a node. And then it could be nice that your application could still survive. So in the last minute, you could move the task from a node to another node in order to survive. And the minimum you should move is, of course, the context, the registers, the execution tag, and the closed process environment. And this is in the neighborhood of 1 kilobyte or so, and you can easily move that. The programming code, this could be bigger. And the way you do that normally is that you duplicate the programming code. So the program of a task should be present at several nodes. So the only thing you need to move is this, which is typically in the neighborhood of 1 kilobyte. But it's still costly to move, especially if you don't have duplicated your programming code or the C code or C++ code or the ADA code you have produced. If it's not duplicated in advance, then you have a lot of data to move, and this would be too costly to do in many cases. And costly means that you cannot do it without sacrificing some deadlines. This would really be bad. So dynamic global scheduling increases fault tolerance. So when a node fails, you just move it, migrate it to other nodes. And also one of the ideals in the server room is load balancing. So you should keep all your nodes at equal at with equal load, so you have some spare time at each node. So this way you can keep your system safe. So the load balancing, which you are normally doing in a server room, is an ideal also in a distributed real time. So let's have a look at real time traffic. So we have two attributes that we are looking at. This is of course the end to end transfer delay and also the jitter. So the jitter is the precision of the end to end transfer delay. So sometimes it will take longer than other times. And we have two aspects of the delay jitter. Due to the different clocks, it could differ small, but also we have big data, which is damaged by, it could be that you have a high load in the network sometimes, and you have a low load in the networks and so on. So you could also have major distortions of the arrival time. But typically we use the word jitter to look at the small distortions in the transfer delay. And this is typically caused by different clocks, slow clocks or something like that. So we have to take into account delay jitter and the transfer delay, the end-to-end. And this is simply the time from the first bit sent to the first bit received. They have slightly definitions throughout the chapter of this end-to-end transfer delay. So let's stick to the first definition that we meet in the chapter. So in a similar way to tasks, one can distinguish between different kind of messages. So remember we had periodic tasks, and when a periodic task sends out a message, then this message will also be periodic. So we can look at the data for a message by looking at its period, the length of the message. This is the number of bits it has. It will determine how long time it will take to send it. And also the delay or the transfer delay of the message is also important. So these are the three numbers that we take into account when you have a periodic message. And they also talk about a fourth parameter, that is the jitter. But this is very hard to judge, the jitter. Secondly, we can also look at sporadic messages, and these are of course generated by sporadic tasks. And this is much more complicated thing to consider, because a sporadic task is characterized by your guaranteed and minimum inter-arrival time of these sporadic tasks or sporadic events. So in order to find some numbers which can characterize a sporadic message, we have to look at this TS. This is the period that they occur in. And we also have this guaranteed minimum interarrival time between instances of these messages. This is also have to be looked at. And we have to look at this average. So we need a big interval so we can calculate the average interarrival time also for that. And this IS is the interval, the long interval that we take the average over of the interarrival times over. And of course we have the length of the message, the number of bits that we have in the message to send, and also the delay of it. So it's a much complicated matter to look at these sporadic messages. And remember, a sporadic task is typically related to sporadic events in a system. So it's not a periodic task, but it's a sporadic task. As we saw in chapter 2, it can be mapped onto a periodic task with a long period. And again, last one, a priori messages. These are the ones that a priori task sends out. And this, when you have an event being processed by a task could send out messages to other tasks. And of course, they have the maximum length, these messages, and they have the end-to-end delay. This is the only thing we can say about those. Yeah, this was just some characterizing of different kinds of messages that we have in our system. So let's look at the queuing delay. So the message delay, the transfer delay. So we have a sending task and we have a receiving task. And then we have split up between the high layers and the low layers in the communication. And the high layers, they typically take care, takes place inside the CPU. This is the higher level where you split up the transaction or the message into some parts. So in the transport layer, you could split them up into small pieces. If your network cannot cope with a big data package, then you have to split it up in smaller ones. Or this splitting up in small packages could also be done in the max hop layer. For instance, in Ethernet, the maximum packet length in the physical length in the Ethernet is 1500 bytes. And the maximum length in Wi-Fi is about 2300 bytes of size. So if you want to send a big file, it has to be split up into smaller packages. And all this work takes place inside the computer, inside the TCP layer of your TCP protocol. And this is done inside your computer. And then the MAC controlling layer, this is a medium access control. So depending on the type of the network, it will take some time also for your task, for your message to be processed inside this one. You have to wait until it's your turn, for instance. And then we have this D3. This is sending out the message on the media. And D4 is the delay, the physical propagation delay. So it's the time that you send out the first bit until you receive the first bit on the media. And then on the receiving side, we have the same again. And we call these D5 and D6 because you have to receive the bits and you have to put them into packages. And these have to be processed in the TCP layer. For instance, if it's a TCP IP communication, which is typical nowadays, and so on. And on the way onto the receiving up here. So this is what happens. And if you can see the time that we use for it, you can see D1 first. This is the high layer processing. And then the processing, the medium access sub-layer. You typically stay in a buffer some time. Then you have the propagation delay up here. And then you send your packets. It takes some time. And it's a bit strange that they show D4 here once more. Because D3 is this interval over here. So it's a bit confusing that they write D4 here. It should only be in one place in the figure. So, but it's not totally incorrect because this interval here is D4. So, but it can be confusing. You might think that you should count D4 twice, but you should only count it once. Yeah, so we see on the next slide, the incoming communication delay is all these summarized. And if you take a closer look at D4, the propagation delay. So in copper cables, the speed of the signal is 200 meters per microsecond. So you can calculate the delay by just measure the length of the copper cable. But in the propagation delay, typically, for instance, in Ethernet, if you have a physical Ethernet, then you will have repeaters for once for every kilometer at least you will have a repeater, or you have a switch. So inside the switch, there will also be a delay, and you should also count this in when you calculate the propagation delay. If you're doing Wi-Fi, of course, you are out in the speed of light. So radio waves, they go with speed of light. But again, when you send them and when you receive them, you also have delays involved. So this also adds up to the propagation delay. If you look at the delay in the higher layers, this is what happens inside the CPU. You could count the instructions that you perform in your program to calculate how much it times. And then you have the issue of that you go from one buffer to another buffer. How much time do you spend in each buffer? And you could also have delay on memory buses. So if you have several CPUs connected to the same memory, the memory bus will also be a delay. In your PC, the typically memory bus speed is 800 megahertz or 1000 megahertz, but the speed of the core could be 2 gigahertz, for instance, so it's 5 times bigger. And you have to take that into account when you calculate the delay of your message. But inside the CPU, it goes fast. We're talking speeds of 1 gigahertz. So it's in general, we just ignore that. But transfer delay between the nodes, it takes time. But again, we have a fight between the CPU speed and the network speed, because nowadays normal in better control is actually we have Ethernet connections drivers of 400 megahertz at least, and in the X15 we have 1 gigahertz drivers for the Ethernet, and the clock speed in the X15 the BeagleBone is 1.5 gigahertz. So the communication speed and the clock speed is actually in the same order. So in this case, we should not ignore the delays inside the CPU when the speed of the network becomes high. And we talk now about 10 gigahertz Ethernet network. And in the lab, they have 40 gigabyte Ethernet works working very well. So we have an ongoing fight between communication speed and clock speed. And in very special dedicated circumstances, we can have communication speeds, which is faster than the clock speed nowadays. So people are also talking about making RAM servers, random access memory servers, as we have file servers. So this could be an option in the future when we have very, very high communication speed. So this is debatable whether we should ignore the delays inside the CPU because the delays between the nodes is so big. If you look at the CAN bus, the communication speed, the propagation delay is this 200 meter per second, microsecond, and the distance in the CAN bus is very small, 10 meter. So you can see 10 meter at most and 5 meter in most cases, because if you look in a car, the distance your car is not more than 5 meters long normally. So the propagation delay will be 1/10 of a microsecond. So this will be, 1/10 of a microsecond delay. And so it's much slower than the CPU that you have available. So in this case, we can ignore the delays inside the CPU and focus on the delay on the network. Yeah, transfer delay. We saw that we should calculate the propagation delay and also the transmission delay. So transmission delay is, of course, the packet length divided with the bit rate that you have on your transmission. So if you have 1 megabit rate and you have 1 megabit and you have, for instance, in the CAN bus, you have 20 bytes to send, then you can calculate how much transmission delay you have. So this will be in the order of 50 microseconds or so. So in general, you cannot ignore what's going on in the network. So D3 and D4 cannot be ignored normally. Yeah, should have a break very soon. Perhaps it's a good place to put in the break. Yeah. So Benedict is nodding. Victor is also nodding, so let's take a break. So I'll pause the recording. Let me share my screen with you. Yeah, so I said a little bit of rubbish at this slide. For instance, if you look at propagation delay in copper, that is 200 meter per microsecond. And if you look at the CAN bus, there we have a distance of 5 to 10 meters. So if we say we have a 10 meters distance in a car, then the propagation delay would be 1/10 of a microsecond. And 1/10 of a microsecond, that is 100 nanoseconds, not 100 microseconds. So this was a bit rubbish, I said that. So it will be, the propagation delay will be in the order of 100 or 50 in nanoseconds when you calculate it. But a bit in a CAN bus, typically you have a speed of 1 megahertz in a CAN bus. So you can see one bit will take 1 microsecond. And a typical CAN bus message will be about, for instance, 100 bit. So we're talking about 100 microseconds for sending a CAN bus message. And it takes only 50 nanoseconds or 100 nanoseconds to send it, as the propagation delay from you start to send the first bit to receive it first bit. Of course, there will also be a delay in the electronics connecting the CPU to the CAN bus. So the CAN bus will of course be, there will be a little delay in electronics, but this is typically a very, very small delay. Yeah. So let's continue. So message scheduling. So the problem of message scheduling. So message time constraints relate to the nature of the task sending the message. Yeah. So the requirements that we have for our real time is in two parts. We have the soft real time and we have the hard real time. I need my laser pen. So we have the hard real-time and soft real-time. And when you have soft real-time, the communication protocol do what is mostly is optimized for, and that is the best effort service. So the focus is on throughput. So how much bit can we stuff through the communication lines per second or per minute? And typically streaming is a good example of this, where we have some soft real-time. And of course, the quality of your movie or your music will depend on the delays that it is caused by it. But real-time protocol is also meant for taking care of that. So in the real-time protocol, you know about FTP and you know about TCP/IP, a TCP protocol. Typically, when you are taught communication, but most communications courses, they forget the RGP protocol. But, and this is pretty dominating today. And this is the one we use for streaming. For instance, when you see a movie, then when people talk, then the voice should also follow their lips. And this means that you have some synchronization points in the stream. So these will be respected at the very end. So you put the sound stream into some buffers and the picture stream into some buffers. And then at the very receiver, you will synchronize it using these synchronization points. And then you get a good movie out of it. So it's an example of soft real time. But hard real time is what we are looking at in this book. So a late message is obsolete and will be discarded. So you will not take that into account if the message comes late. And this might be very dangerous, for instance, at Danfoss Rise when the controller motor, if you lose knowledge of where you are in the revolution, if you lose it, I think they say that down to, if you lose one or two, more than 2 degrees position in the motor revolution, then you might lose the control of the motor totally, because you need to know where the shaft is in its rotation before you put in the currents into the coils that controls, that gives energy to the rotation. So a late message in a motor control is very dangerous. So in a car, you might ruin your pistons and the valves around the pistons. They may be destroyed if the motor control is losing a message or so. So a communication protocol must deliver predictable service. It must also guarantee maximum transfer delay. And this is actually what we are looking for. We need to have a deterministic time for the maximum delay that can occur when we send a message. And we have some protocols which actually deliver such service. One of the first one was Token Bus, made by General Motors. And there's a joke here. The maximum length of the cable in a Token Bus, that is 7 kilometers. And why so? Because this was the length of the longest production line for cars in General Motors. So General Motors had a big influence on this Token Bus. So it is a cable-based. They share the same cable, all the stations, but they have a token. So when you are a station that wants to send, you have a token. And you have this only for a short period of time. And then you have to send the token to the next station. And then it can send some messages. So the token passes on from station to station, and they can send messages. And in Token Bus, you have a little slot. You have a slot this, in front of you that you always have, where you can send what they call synchronous messages. So there you can send some real-time package, and then you have a guarantee for how long it will take to receive to get it. And then you have a lower priority package also you can send if you have enough time. And depending on the status on the bus, you can have the token for shorter time or longer time. So you look at the token rotation time and you have to return it to the next station if when your token rotation time is has run out for you. And then it works. So they have a class for real-time packages in Token Bus. CAN Bus will take that in detail a bit later. Profinet is also an industrial bus made by Siemens. And this Profinet is a real-time version of it. And then we have the new big animal in the zoo, the time-sensitive net. I will talk about this after Easter. And et cetera. But in fact, it's not so many protocols. So very, very few protocol delivers real-time guarantees to us. So we have some problems to look into. And the first problem is that we look into a packet switch network. This means that we don't have a communication line where we just can send bits. We have to split up our communication into packages, which are sent one by one. And these packages that you send can follow different routes in the network. And then we have a lost control of what's going on. So even if we have an ATM switch or an IP router, we don't really know how they are connected inside the network and so on. So this ATM switch was the one I was talking about when we taught students how the telephone companies did the data transfer. And to my knowledge, no one is using these ATM switches anymore. It's just plain IP routers they use in the telephone companies. Yeah, so they, when the telephone companies send you a, sell you a service, then they will also give you some parameters. So you can, if you pay more, you get a lower loss rate. And if you pay more, then you can get a lower maximum transfer delay, so to speak. But these guys, they are cheating, you know. For instance, this UC company is actually a old Danish telephone company, TDC. And the people, they paid for a certain service, but Sunday evening, when a lot of using the internet, they could see that they didn't get what they paid were paying for. So they had to suffer from long delays Sunday evening. So even if you pay for a fiber, then you cannot be sure that they handle this as a fiber. So sometimes they cheat. So you share your fiber with others. So even if you buy a fiber, then you only buy the capacity of the fiber. And there's an old joke here. I think, I don't know if I told it before. University has two redundant connections to Odense fibers, and we are paying for them to be redundant. But it turns out that these two fibers, they actually meet down in a small town called Bo, near the German border. And there was a digging machine down there, digging, and it disconnected these two fibers. Then we lost connection to Odense, even if we had two redundant fibers. And then, but they met at the same place down there. So we can't be sure what's going on in the packet switch networks. So the time constraints, as I say, are entirely handled by network switches. So we can't get any guarantees. We can sign up a contract, but we can't really rely on any guarantees for real time here. So, but when you come to the local area networks, then we are in control. One definition of local area networks is that they are inside our own property. So for instance, at Alcyon, it's our own property and our local area networks are within the building. So we are in full control of what's going on. But the medium access techniques, in old days, we had a token bus, we had token ring, and we had Ethernet. And the one who won was Ethernet. And all the control techniques there are random. So it's first come, first serve techniques. So if you want to send a package, first come will get his package out on the cable. And then you have to wait. And there is no deterministic time of waiting guaranteed. So we just have to wait. So the winner doesn't guarantee any real-time performance on the LAN for us, the internet. It could have been done in the Wi-Fi because there it's not so random anymore because we can't afford to have collisions in Wi-Fi. So it's collision-free, but still, will not be guaranteed that we can get first in the queue and get first served. So it's a bit random, the delay that we experience in these networks. But when we go to industrial buses, then we have a better chance, as I said before. CAN bus offers real-time deliverance, and Profinet also does, and some other few other of the industrial buses offer this real-time assurance. But in general, our LAN is not offering us this capability. But with TSN, the future will be bright for real-time networks. And then some principles and our policies. Of course, we have this guarantee strategy that we would like to get. So, but as I said, even if you buy it, you cannot be sure that you get it. Then you have these probabilistic and statistical strategies where you typically you pay that 90% of your message will not be delayed. And of course you can get that. So again, get a, and typically in these contracts, you will get your money back if you don't get the service that you pay for. So what the networks providers is doing is this best effort because they are interested in throughput, but the customers are interested in response time and the quality of their communication. And we have this conflict between the providers and the consumers. So, and this is an ongoing conflict. But nowadays in the wide area networks and also in most lands, we have fibers available. So we are talking gigahertz. So in many cases, normal users don't experience waiting times because the fibers are so fast. And also the Wi-Fi is very fast nowadays. Wi-Fi is close to 400, 500 megahertz, 500 megabits per second now. And you can say for a normal user, if you want to send an email, then you could be satisfied with some kilobytes. If you want to see, listen to sound, then you are satisfied with a megabyte per second. But if you want to see a movie, then you should at least have 10 megabytes per second. And apart from that, normal people don't need anymore. So when your internet provider sells you 100 megabit connections or 500 megabit connections, you will never come in need for that. So this is the more clever fools, the less clever person, you know. So message scheduling differs from normal scheduling that one has to consider only non-preemptive algorithms. This is most networks, when you send a package, you can't stop, you can't preempt it and send and set it on pause and send another package. Because if you stop a package, it's broken and you have to retransmit it. So you can't do that in 99% of all the protocols. But in the new one, TSN, you can actually preempt a package which is being sent on the net. If you have some very important things to send, you can just stop the transmission of a package between two stations and then send your own package. And then these two poor stations who are talking together will have to resume and retransmit the packet later on when they get time. And then there's two statements here which are very strange if you try to read them. One has to use preemptive algorithms with the proviso. This means under the condition that transmission delays of messages are lower than or equal to the basic time unit of allocation of the medium to nodes. Try to swallow that sentence. I read it many times and it makes no sense. And the next one is not much better. One has to bear in mind that long messages are segmented by a sending node. Small packets, but they can also be segmented by the networks. For instance, the Ethernet, the maximum packet size is 1500 bytes. And in Wi-Fi, it's 2300 bytes. And this segmentation and reassembly was carried out by a layer above the max hop layer. No, not always. If your Ethernet, it will be taken care of down in the max hop layer also. And to see these concerns in transport layer, they can also be done by a TCP layer. It can also do fragmentation. But the networks, they can also do fragmentation. And the max hop layer can also do it. So this is also close to some rubbish. But the fact is that long messages, we can't rely on real-time properties or deadline properties of those because they can be segmented into smaller messages, and these are typically routed by their own. Okay, 643 is where we come close to real life, not so much talk anymore. So they consider three real-time networks. Just consider token bus, but token bus, yeah, it's obsolete nowadays, no one is using it. Perhaps General Motors is still using it in the production halls, but no one else is using it. Then there's talk about this EFI protocol. And this is a protocol for oscilloscopes and equipment that you connect to an oscilloscope. And this is very, very special. So this is not what you're going to program in the future. But CANPOS has been around since 20 or 30 years old. It's very successful. And the success was guaranteed, of course, because it's a car network. So if you have a car, you have a CAN network. So it's a very live community, the CANPOS. If you want to know about it, you can search for something called CAN Kingdom. And this is a huge standard with a lot of possibilities and so on. So it's a very active community, and our BeagleBone, and I don't think Raspberry Pi has a CANPOS, but our BeagleBone has a CANPOS built in, so you can use it right away. And many microcontrollers has CANPOS controllers also. And so this is a widely used bus in embedded systems, the CANPOS. So let's see how it works. It's a shared medium, so only one can send a packet at a time. And the one who to send is decided upon a little competition. So we have, you can see on the next slide, we have this arbitration field here, 12 bits. So in the, during these 12 bits, all are sending. So the conversation starts after this start of frame, after the first bit, then everyone is awake. And now there's a competition to be made. And the winner will get the right to send on the cable. So let's look at three nodes, which tries to get access to the network. So they have their own identifier. So this is the identifier of the first node, 01010111. Identifier for the node 2 is 011101, 01, so on. Identifier sent by node 3 is 01001. And they start to send out the first bit of the identifier. And in this case, it's 0 for all three of them. So they send out 0 on the bus. So there will be no voltage on the bus. And everyone senses that also, so they can sense. For instance, node 1 sends out 0 and may sense that, okay, the bus status is 0. So I probably won the competition, but we have to continue until we lose. So then we send the next bit out. And for all of these three, they have by accident the same number. So they send one out, all of them. And they all discovered that now we have a voltage on the bus. So they can continue the competition. They're still not lost. In the next period, they send out, node 1 send out 0, node 2 send out 1, and node 3 send out 0. And it's the case that those who drag the bus low will always win. So node 2 tries to keep the voltage on the bus high, but those who put 0 on the bus, they will win. So the bus status will be 0. So node 3 notice that it sent out a 0 and the bus status is 0. But node 2 now notice it tries to send out a high and the bus is dragged down to low. And now it knows that it has lost in the competition. So it gives up. So we have two left in the competition, 1 and 3. So at the fourth, they both send out a 1. So they both notice that the bus is high. So they continue the competition. And then at the fifth, you see, yeah, the fifth bit, node 3 sends out, no. What? 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. At the fifth bit, they both send out 0. Oh, sorry, it's 1 here. Yeah. At the fifth bit, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah. The fifth bit, the node 3 sends out a 0. And at the fifth bit, then the node 1 sends out a 1. So when you send out a 0 on the bus, it will be dragged the voltage down to 0. And node 1 discovers that the bus status is 0, and it tries to keep it high, and it knows that it has lost. So the winner of the game will be node 3, because these identifiers are unique. So node 2, you can't have two nodes in a CAN bus which has the same identifier. So the winner is the one with the lowest number. So this way we have a priority system. So we can say those who have real-time needs, they we give them low identifiers. And those who just send the messages, which doesn't depend on real-time deadlines, they can do, we can give them higher identifiers. So let's have a look at the CAN bus itself. So we want to get an overview of the transmission delay. So transmission delay is, as we saw, it was the propagation delay plus the time it takes to send the packets on the network. And it's nice for doing exercises in, because the typical speed of a CAN bus is 1 megahertz, and it plays very well with microseconds. So 1 megahertz is that you send one bit in one microsecond. So what we have to do is just to count all our bits that we are sending, then we know how long time it takes to send them. Remember the propagation delay? It was 200 meter per microsecond. And the distance that you have for a CAN bus is typically 5 meters, and not more than 10 meters. So if you say 10 meters, and 200 meters per second, so it'd be 1/20. We'd have to divide 1 microsecond with 20. So that will be 50 nanoseconds, which is a propagation delay. And if you look at this number, it will be in the order of 100 microseconds. So 50 nanoseconds compared to 100 microseconds, then we can ignore the propagation delay. So we do that in our calculations. Otherwise, we had to add it to this number. So let's see how we calculate it. So for a message, you can calculate all this. If you sum it up, then you have 47 from the fixed field. That is 1 plus 13 plus 6. And we have 8N, that is the data part. Then we have the CRC code. This is a cyclic redundancy check. So you make polynomial divisions with this 15 bits, 16 bits. And then when you divide this 16 bits up in the polynomial of this, then you get a remainder, and you put this remainder in here. And the receiver will do the division again. And if you don't get this remainder, then there's an error. And remember, if you had a data communication course, CRC checks are very, very efficient. So they will catch 99% of all 99.999% of all 1-bit errors, and about 90% of all 2-bit errors, and so on. So it is very efficient to discover bit errors, the CRC checks. And we have 2 bits where the receiver of the package can acknowledge. So it happens in real time, this acknowledge. So the sender will send all this. So the receiver will calculate the CRC the remainder. And while the package is on the bus, it will set one of these bits. And then the sender will look for whether these bits are set or not, and get a confirmation of whether it was received successfully or not by the receiver. So it happens in real time, this acknowledgement. And then there's an end of frame, and there's an inter-frame distance also. So all the stations know when a new package is about to start. So if you sum up all these numbers here, then you should get 47 out of it. So 13, 19 plus 16, that is 35 plus 2. 37 plus 7, that is 44. Plus 3 bits, that is 47. When you sum it up. And then a date, the data port part could be from 0 to 8 bytes. So this is this part of it. But then we have bit stuffing in the CAN bus. So each station has a clock, and it uses these transitions on the bus to synchronize their clocks. So when you go from high to low, yeah, then you can synchronize your clock. And then you wait for the next high to low or low to high to synchronize it again. So you can see the problem here. If you have a long, long, low row of ones, then you don't have any change in the bus, and then your clock might drift a bit. So it's not that precise anymore. So in order to put in long series of zero and long series of one, then we put in an opposite bit from time to time. This is called bit stuffing, just so that we minimize the drift of clocks. So every time you have four bits in a row, then you add a new bit. So here you see you have stuff bits here. Yeah. So every time you have four bits, which are identical, 1, 2, 3, 4, here, yeah, then you put in an opposite bit, and these are called bits. This is called bit stuffing. It also happens here after four identical ones, you put in a zero, just to force it to switch. And also in this long sequence, you put in a zero. And the same will happen if you have a long row of zeros, then you put in a one. Wait a minute, I'm not sure of that, because you wake up for the starter frame on a one bit. So it's only you put in zeros. This way, you could get some artificial shifts where you can synchronize your clock as a station. But this has to be removed again, because they disturb the meaning, of course, if you put additional zeros into the bytes. So this will be unstuffed again at the receiver. But they fill up these stuffed bits, and the stuffed part of this is only 34. So you can see bit stuffing area. So this is the only place where we put in additional zeros. So we have to take that into account. And this area is 30 bit long. And we also, so the fixed area. But in this area, we also have the data. And this is 8 n long. So the number of zeros that we could add is this number divided by 4. So for every time we see 4 ones, it will be a zero will be stuffed into the stream. So this also takes place. And this symbol is the integer, which is lower, the whole number, which is lower than this fraction. So this is our formula for the lengths, bit lengths of a CAN bus message. So now you see, this is not a way to transfer files, no, because we only maximum get 8 bytes of communication here. But you can send a number. You could set typically if you have a float number, you could set a number to another station, or you could send a command to another station. This is what you use your command CAN bus for, synchronization and sending small numbers or big numbers. But the numbers, you only have 8 bytes to put it in. So this is how we do it. So let's have a look at some examples here. So you can see this column over here. If we have a length of 2 bytes, use this formula, then this will take 75 microseconds if you calculate it with 2 bytes in here. And you have a 4-byte message. It should be try should have 16 bytes, 16 bits more. Yeah, so we get 95. Because this will also increase a bit, so you get 16 plus one quarter of it longer. So 16 plus 4, that is 20. So it's 20 bits longer than this with 2 bytes and so on. And then with 8 bytes, you get the length of the message will be 135 bits. So using this formula, we can calculate this column of values. And now we come to the clue. What is the maximum delay that we can experience when we send on a CAN bus? So let's imagine that these messages M1 to M6 are sent by stations, where M1 is come from station 1, M2 from station 2, and M1 has the lowest identifier. This means that it has the highest priority. It will win competitions when it has the lowest number. So the worst case for the message M1 sent from station 1 would be that M4 is on the bus sending, because M4 message, you see, they are 8 bytes long, and it takes 135 microseconds to send. So the worst case for M1 is that M4 is sending, because we cannot interrupt one who is sending. We have to wait until the transmission is over. And then there will be a competition, and station 1 will always win this competition. So it can send this package, and it takes 75 microseconds to send. So the total delay of M1 will be this sum. When we look at a package from station 2, the worst case will be, again, M4 is on the bus, and it takes 135. And station 1 is ready to send M1. And when you make a competition with this station, you will lose. So we'll have to wait until M1 has been sent. That is this time. And the next competition, if station 1 is not sending anything, then we'll win in this case. So this is a delay for maximum delay for M2. And so on for M3. It has to wait until M1 and M2 has sent, and then it can send M3. But for M4 it's different, because it cannot wait for itself to send. So it's not, M4 is not on the bus. So we have to look what could be the worst case be for us. The worst case is that M1, M2, and M3, and M3 are ready to send. So we have to wait for these three to send out here. Here. We have to wait for the three previous to send their package, and then we can send the package, and so on for M5 and M6. So this is how the message schedule goes on when you have a CAN bus. So this is the worst case delay that we can experience. We have to take that into account when we do our schedules. And if you look when we in the computer, we're talking about nanoseconds typically, but up here we are in the microsecond scale. And now for exercise 6.1 in the book. I will put you into groups immediately, because we have 45 minutes left. So you can start your group with a little break and then start on exercise 6.1 in the book. It's a nasty exercise because it combines knowledge from chapter 3 with knowledge from this new chapter. So you have to remember how we do this partial ordering of messages. So we have constraints. Some messages has to come before other messages, and we have to put in new deadlines and new releases in our schedule. Yeah. Should we just have a look at it before we go to break? So I shouldn't have said the break word. So where are it? Right here. Chapter 7, let's go back. So here we are. I will just make it a bit bigger. Ah, it's too big. 150 should be enough. Yeah. So this is the situation. We have 5 tasks. We have some releases here. This is in microseconds, so tau 2 is released later than all of them. They have this computation time, 1,000 microseconds, that is 1 millisecond. And then we have these deadlines, also microseconds. And this is the distribution of them. Tau 1 and tau 3 are node 1. Tau 5 is on node 3. And we have tau 2 and tau 4 on node M3. And we have a CAN bus connecting them. And now we have to calculate new releases and new deadlines using the earliest deadline first. Yeah. So first you compute the transmission delay of these messages. And then you modify the initial tasks, releases, and deadlines in order to take into account these local precedence constraints, as you can see up here. Tau 1 has to execute before tau 3, tau 2 has to execute before tau 4, and tau 4 has to execute after tau 1 and after tau 2. And you see tau 4 is waiting for a message from tau 1. So you have to calculate the execution time of this one and then add the propagation delay, so the message delay of M1. So we can see the earliest point where tau 4 can start. In the same way, you have to modify the deadlines also, going backwards. And we assume that we're doing earliest deadline first scheduling in this question too. So what are the new values of the task parameters? The rest of the questions are a bit strange, so we don't do those. So we do question 1 and 2 after when I put you into groups. So I guess, is it the usual groups? Right, just write in the chat. Yeah, we have Zorve, Miran. So Akman and Kush. Yeah, I think you. Usual group will do. So 2 groups. So Victor, Abdul, Benedict, and Ankush. Ankush, are you normally with Miran?
Any group.
Any group, okay. And Ahmed, you are with Abdul normally? Yeah. Yeah. As always, it's with Miran. And Min, you are also with Abdul's group normally. Yeah. Okay, so let's spread you out in the rooms. Yeah, so Abdul, Ahmed, Benedict, Victor, that would be 4. Yeah, so we can take Ankus in those one. Yeah. So Min and Trit, I will put you together with Miran and Zola. So I think this is okay. So I'll open the group. We have 1 group of 5 and 1 group of 4.
Can you also send the exercise, like the picture of it?
You don't have the book?
No.
Okay. I can copy it. Yeah, I'll send it, put it in it. Okay. Thank you.